Hello, John.
Hello, Barbara.
So today we're going to talk about the Pope's Cross. The Pope's Cross was commissioned for his visit on 29th September 1979. It's 116 feet tall. At the time, it had no planning permission, but that was naturalized in 1981.
Yes.
The Pope's visit created a baby boom 9 months later, and there's a book by David McWilliams called The Pope's Children. Charles Haughey at the time wasn't in favor of the cross until he met Archbishop Dermot Ryan, and then he was in full agreement that it would become a major tourist attraction in the future and that it should be further developed for tourism, which we'll talk about later, which hasn't really been done. Okay.
No,
The
was Charlie Haughey at Taoiseach Prime Minister at the time of the Pope's visit.
He must have been, but he wasn't in favor of it, and he had to deal with Dermot Ryan, Archbishop Dermot Ryan, because he needed some convincing. But he was convinced in the end that it was a very good idea and that it would create major tourism for the Phoenix Park. And it has become a major tourist attraction. You do get a lot of tourist buses going up there. And when you see an ice cream van anywhere, you know that that there's tourists around, okay?
Yes.
But the thing is that it was designed by Ronnie Tallon. Ronnie Tallon was a gifted architect. He was a very humble man, very quiet, very private, and he passed away in 2014. So let's talk about the Papal Cross and what you thought when you visited it as well. Do you remember?
Yes. Well, the Papal Cross, that was a good thing to do, and not just a good thing, but a thing that any sensible person would do after the visit of Pope John Paul II, one of the best popes, in my opinion, that I ever heard tell of, except, of course, well, along with Pope Pius X, whom I admire greatly, and Pope Benedict, of course. But Pope John Paul II came on the world stage from a very tough background. When he was a priest in Poland, he had to do it underground. The Nazis were there and persecuted, killed a third of the priests of Poland in concentration camps. That's what evil people do. So Pope John Paul II became a bishop and then a cardinal. And then he was elected Pope because he had a great way about him, common sense. So when he visited Poland and his next port of call was Dublin, that was a great honor. I don't hear it referred to by many commentators, but John Malone of the Christian TV Ireland Project will comment on it very favorably and show some excerpts of it in due course when we're up and running.
Yeah,
Now,
John, I just want just to say
over a
to
million people. There was over a million people at that event in Croke Park, and I have to congratulate the COE, Corps Umpire, and the transport company, and they put on trains from stations that there hadn't been trains for years, and all converged towards Croke Park, so that we got a train. And from the
yeah.
suburbs, and were able to be in plenty of time, and places were reserved from people for people from different areas, so that you knew where you were going, and there were stewards, so you were brought to the area from you were from, and there was other people from that area too. So they did. There was great organisation done fairly quickly, and what they all have to be congratulated for what they did. It was a great occasion when the Pope. I came over Phoenix Park in the Aer Lingus Boeing jet, and called St. Patrick, well named,
Yeah, I just
and
want
came over, and it appeared to be going slow. Go ahead.
to. Yeah, I just want to say that, John, while you're talking there, I think your hands or your feet are kicking the table because your screen is shaking all the time. So,
Right, right,
are you
right.
touching the laptop or something? There's something going on there. Yeah,
Well,
just to let
I'm
you know.
touching
Anyway, okay. Anyway,
okay.
but yeah, so it was a fantastic occasion. I think there was 1.25 million people or something in the park. So there was the figures like
Yeah,
that,
more than a million. Yeah.
you know, and
And they were all accommodated and all got communion.
they were
And we could
indeed.
hear the Pope. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hold
So the
on now.
question
Let me
is,
just finish it. Yeah, go ahead.
some people were asking, what's under the Pope's cross? Because there is something under the Pope's cross, okay? So
Yes.
when it was designed, okay, there's a chamber under the Pope's cross, okay? So when you're facing the cross, when you're facing the steps as you're going up to the right, okay, to the right-hand side of it, okay, there used to be a huge gate going in there, and it was all done in granite. It was very, very, very nice, okay? But over time, the actual cross, the chamber filled with water, okay? So what they done was Office of Public Works or the Dublin City Council, whoever looks after it, they filled it in with earth, basically, the actual gate part, okay? So you can no longer see inside, but there was a chamber in there. And we were talking about it, myself and yourself, we were talking about it would actually make a nice restaurant if they done something, you know, to, or you were saying an oratory, maybe a church, if you remember.
Yes, I think myself, an oratory and a church would be the best for underneath that cross where that marvellous Pope, Pope John Paul II, that great Pope from Poland, that brought such great good to the world and spelled the end of communism. They tried to assassinate him in 1981, but thank God, the miraculous men had saved him. Now, yeah. That's what should happen there. As a matter of fact, not alone should it have happened, but it should have already happened. It tells me the sort of silence of our bishops and all the rest in charge, because they should have demanded and asked the faithful to, which we would have. Done everything possible to have that happen, so that that oratory could have been up and running for years and well looked after, and mass celebrated in it, perhaps every week, and the exposition of the Blessed Sacrament. Look at the great loss that we've had all these years. I'm reaching a certain age now, and I was there when I was a younger man in 1979. And I kind of, now that you've told me that, because I've often visited that. As a matter of fact, we did a video there one time up there, and I noticed a lot of tourist buses. And I noticed a complete lack of facilities for tourists and visitors. Do you think that would happen in Knock in County Mayo if they adopted that attitude? They wouldn't have the visitors that they have over a million a year, and an airport built near Knock for facilitates all the pilgrims coming to the country. Mm-hmm. Now, that's the first thing that should have happened years ago. But we certainly are now saying that it's long overdue to build an oratory there and to put that back to its proper use, that people, when they visit that, can visit the oratory. Look at the amount of tourists and support that would get. You can't put even a number on it. Okay. I would say we had tourists coming to pay it a visit. But by all means, for goodness sake, put some facilities there for tourists that they can have a cup of coffee and maybe a sandwich or something.
Okay, John, I have to stop the video for a second, unfortunately, okay? We'll continue in a second. Okay, it's just a whole pile of water is after coming out of your mouth, and I'm wondering, did it fall on the laptop?
No, it didn't.
Okay. The other thing is, you keep shaking the table. It's impossible to see.
Oh, right. It's too near.
Push it out there, okay? Yeah, make sure your feet aren't touching the table.
No, my feet is well away from.
You keep kicking it or something, and it keeps shaking. Okay. So anyway, that's grand. So we can continue anyway. So let's continue from there and say, okay, it's a great tourist attraction. Go ahead.
It's a great tourist attraction. People come from all over the world to visit that site in buses and probably in cars. And I think it's kind of long overdue again for to have some facilities for those tourists, perhaps toilets, and also some kind of facilities by way of where they could have a cup of coffee or a cup of tea and a sandwich or a mineral or whatever it is, some facilities of that calibre. I mean, and maybe a tourist, a tourist office, and a place for people that could get mementos of the Pope's visit to this country, and kind of a little religious shop of the line of what Veritas have. They would be well qualified to operate one there.
Absolutely.
The thing about it is,
I mean, what's sad is there's no facilities, and I'm sure for the Pope's visit underneath the cross, there was a bathroom. There would have had to have been, right? Okay. So it's probably plumbed already. But the thing about it is, it's sad that there's no coffee shop, as you say. There's nothing there for a visitor. There's not even a toilet. And it's a sad fact that The only thing you can get up there is
See,
an ice cream
it's a form
cone.
of an,
It's an ice cream
it's a
cone
form,
from an ice cream van, which costs about 4 euros. That's all it
it's
has
the
to
only
offer.
thing.
Yeah.
Look, it's a complete incompetence, and certainly John Malone, the Christian TV Ireland project, is demanding that to be done forthwith.
Yeah, it could be. I think it'd be a very good idea. That and maybe sorting out the parking in the park because, as I said, we've done a video and we're going to continue it today. About there's no parking anymore in the park, you know.
Yes, yeah, certainly, yeah.
So there you go. Listen, thanks very much, John. Actually, before I
Thank
go,
you very
actually,
much.
I forgot to say, actually, there was objections to the Pope's visit by Ian Paisley at the time, and I'm not sure if you remember that. I don't think the Pope actually went to the north of Ireland, did he?
No, because it was considered the forces of evil up there, represented by this so-called reverend with a small R. He was an absolute bigot of the worst order, and he left a terrible legacy in that neck of the woods. He repented and become First Minister and a good colleague of Martin McGuinness, the Sinn Féin leader in the north, a deputy leader of Sinn Féin, and they got on very well and were known as the Chuckle Kids because he must have had a conversion, but the harm he did was incalculable. He caused a lot of misery in that part of the world, and Charlie Haughey, our peace Taoiseach and ex Prime Minister, had said the true word was a failed state, which it is,
Yeah.
and it still is because the foreigner has control up there, and it by rights belongs to this part of the country, Ireland, not
Yeah.
England.
At the time, I remember there was uproar because the carpets for the papal visit, which were 2 acres in size, okay, they were transported
Yes.
on three lorries, okay, from
Yes.
Antrim, and the papers, the evening press, I think at the time, wrote an article about it, you know, that they came from Antrim, but the Pope wouldn't be going anywhere up there or something. I vaguely remembered it as a kid. There was something in the news.
It's very good. Well, I don't even remember that. I
Yeah.
remember Frank Patterson, the famous tenor, singing Panis and Gallicus. It was such a very lovely occasion that I have very happy memories of it, and I'm delighted that I was there on that famous day.
Very good. Okay, well, thank you very much, John.
Thank you very much, Ivor.
No.